Chapter 11 of the Music Hall Managers of Other Days. I've already mentioned casually that there were only a few regular music halls. Those familiar with our music halls of the present day cannot possibly have any idea what these were like. As one example, I may mention the old Gaiety at Liverpool, which was patronised by paperboys, loafers, orange girls, flower sellers, and so on. At this hall, there were two shows a night, and both houses were generally pretty full unless an event occurred in the town which kept the usual patrons busy selling papers or otherwise profitably engaged. The hall itself was little more than a draughty barn with wooden benches, but great efforts were made to give it an air of respectability, and upon the walls were notices to the effect that ladies would not be allowed in the stalls without shoes and stockings. Another well-remembered old house in the Midlands was situated in a thickly populated manufacturing and colliery town. It was a sort of tin shanty kept by a miserly old man who was so fearful of being robbed that he alone superintended the box office, hobbling backwards and forwards from window to window, taking stall money at one, pit money at another, and so on. After every show, he searched the floor religiously for any cigar or cigarette ends that his patrons had left behind them, and these he either smoked in his own pipe or supplied again to his clients in the shape of cigarettes, which became far famed for their excellence and cheapness. In the winter time, he added to his income by supplying his patrons with hot chestnuts, which he roasted himself on a couple of stoves in a room directly beneath the stage. As already mentioned, the only two really profitable nights in each week were Saturdays and Mondays, and as it was the custom to engage artists for a week at a time, those who kept these music halls were constantly on the lookout for some device which would enable them to cut their salary list during the intervening days. To this end, our chestnut-roasting friend accidentally hit upon a magnificent scheme. When his chestnut business grew, and he found it expedient to install his two stoves in the only available place, which was beneath the stage, he found that the fumes therefrom escaped through the chinks of the boards and interfered with the performance of the artistes on the stage. To obviate this, he had a sheet of metal fitted above the stoves, but this was so arranged that it could be slid back and the fumes thus allowed to ascend. As a rule, the programme was made up of various artistes at small salaries and one turn which was a big draw and which accordingly received big money, £3 per week or something even more fabulous. The performer, who was in receipt of this princely sum, would duly delight his audience during the first part of the show on Monday night, but when he came to give his last item, the boss would suddenly stoke up the fires, pull back the iron sheet, and allow the fetid fumes of the fiery furnace to fizz furiously and filter falteringly through the fractured floor. The result was that about the middle of his second verse, the singer was seized with a fit of coughing, which continued at intervals throughout the rest of his song, until the apparently infuriated manager rushed into the wings and bade him come off, telling him he was obviously ill and unfit to appear, and that he must take 4 or 5 days' rest until he was well again. Apologies and protestations were of no avail. The unfortunate star invariably failed to be persuasive as to his recovery until Saturday morning, and the days he had been away were accordingly deducted from his screw. Almost equally ingenious was the plan of campaign of the proprietor of a hall in Ireland. If on Monday night one or more of the turns went badly, it was naturally desirable, if possible, to get rid of them, and avoid having to pay during the rest of the week for a show which did not draw. Those who appeared at this hall used to be astounded at the conclusion of Monday night's performance by the proprietor invariably singling out the turn or turns which had fallen most utterly flat in order to lavish his praise and comments upon them. The comic singer who had brought the house down never had a word of encouragement, but he who, in spite of all his strivings, had failed to get a single hand, was approached by the manager most effusively, was patted upon the back, and was assured that the audience was composed entirely of fools who did not know how to appreciate a good thing. Such encouragement naturally raised much friendly feeling. Next afternoon, the manager would invite the favoured ones to come out for a drive in the country with him, upon which he would show them many of the beauties of the neighbourhood. Having driven them to some beautiful but lonely spot and given them tea there, he and his wife would drive off home, telling them there was no hurry, but that they might stay and look round for a bit and return by the next train so as to be in time for the evening performance. But to their consternation, they invariably discovered that there was no train, nor any possible way of returning before the advertised time of their appearance. They usually arrived breathless with hurry, having spent a considerable sum in hiring a conveyance, just before the close of the performance, and they were invariably met with an icy frigidity, and the information that such unpunctuality must of course be rewarded with instant dismissal. These are but two examples to show how some music halls were run in those days. But while the managers of such places were cute enough, they were often most illiterate men. There was one individual who was always referred to among artists as Dear Six, on account of the fact that his letters so constantly began somewhat as follows. Dear Six, what are your lowest terms for monkey next? By monkey, he meant Monday, of course, but this is only a sample to give some idea of the enormous change which has taken place during the last 20 years or so. As in most things, there were exceptions in the way of managers. There was one man at Dublin, I did not meet him myself till later, who was by way of being a bit of a wit. His great joke was to waylay you in the bar, pat you on the back, and in the most familiar and kindly way ask you if you would have a drink. If you timidly confessed that you would like a whiskey and soda, he would call the young lady behind the bar and tell her you wanted a whiskey and soda, and would then walk out, laughing fit to burst, and leaving you to pay for it. I remember another individual who took a tremendous pride in the appearance of his hall, and particularly of the ceiling, which he had done up in elaborate style. On one occasion, he engaged some trapezists who wanted to fix up their apparatus to the roof. As this meant boring holes and disfiguring his paint, he would not hear of it. "There'll be no flying trapeze here," said he, "unless you can fix it on the floor." But of all the managers, there was no one in the same street with Mr. Lees of the Star at Liverpool. Mr. Lees was a gentleman far too good for his profession in those days, and it was the great ambition of all pros to get an engagement there, particularly at Christmas, when bookings were made for runs of 4 weeks. I played there first in April 89, and went there again for several weeks in the following December, and again the following year for a fortnight. Mr. Lees looked after his people and took a real interest in them, often and often going out of his way to do them a good turn. Many a time some poor fellow earning £2 or £3 a week, who arrived at the Star at the end of his resources, was cheered and helped by the kindly manager, who, seeing his glum looks, would approach him with a bright smile and a, "Look here, my lad, would you like part of your money advanced?" Alas, men like this were all too few, or the profession would then have been a very different affair.